Welcome to the weekly webcast. Each week, these messages are brought to you with practical help for daily living from our teacher and pastor, John S. Torell. Our hope is that you'll be encouraged and challenged by this message and that you'll share it with a friend. This morning, Pastor John continues a series entitled, The Prophet Jeremiah. God never changes. That can be difficult for mankind to understand since we are ruled by our emotions and they often betray us. However, just like us, God has emotions, but they do not rule Him. We all react to the environment around us, and our responses vary from muted to violent eruptions. But even when a response is outwardly muted, that does not mean that everything is calm on the inside. The trend is to control your emotions and make sure that you do not antagonize other people. We don't do this because we like them, but because our behavior can affect us in a positive or negative manner. When it comes to God, there is often no consideration that we might be grieving the Lord or what He wants from us. This message is entitled, Emotions and Choices. Now, let's join Pastor John as he begins today's message.
Praise the Lord and welcome to Resurrection Life of Jesus Church worldwide. And I'm happy to have you here today, and we're going to be talking about emotions and repentance. Every one of us learns some skills as we're growing up. You got emotions, everybody else got emotions. And so we learn the skills how to deal with one another. On your job, in your relationship, with marriage, with your children, we do know this, that if I want to have peace, tranquility, working, I need to learn to navigate and treat people in such a way that they would treat me nicely. So this is something we learn. Now, when you get drunk or you have alcohol in you, drugs, your perception goes out, and people that are lubricated with alcohol, you know, they say stupid things, do stupid things, and they cause accidents and things of that nature. If you get mentally ill, your mouth is running, and you know you have a problem getting along, so they have to lock you up. So, God has emotions, and we need to learn how to get along with God if you want to have a good life. In Genesis chapter 1, we read verses number 26 and 27. We are told we are made in the image of God. And God said, let us make man in our image, after our likeness. Let them have dominion over the fish of the sea, and over the fowl of the air, over the cattle, and over all the earth, and over every creeping thing that creeps on the earth. So God created man in his own image. In the image of God created him. Male and female created he them. So, we are made in the image of God. God has emotions. God is a person, not a human being, but he has a personality. There are things he likes, there are things he does not like. He has set forth certain things. He says, now, I want this to happen. If this not happen, I will make a correction. And so we need to have respect for God. We need to begin to understand God is not an ATM machine that we can go to. And you hear a lot of preachers, God is love, you know, God understands. Don't worry about anything, God is love. The problem is, God does not understand. He has his own way, his thinking, His spiritual laws, physical laws, and he expects us to line up with him. If we turn to Hebrews chapter 4, we find out now that we have a body and a soul and a spirit. For the word of God is quick and powerful and sharper than any two-edged sword, piercing even to the dividing asunder of soul and spirit, and of joints and marrow, and is a discerner of thoughts and intents of the heart. So you and I, as human beings, we have a physical body, we have a soul, and we have a spirit. The physical body is a vehicle. This body that I have is not going to make it into heaven. It's from the earth. It's going to stay on the earth. It's going to burn up with the earth. When we are resurrected, God is going to take the molecules of this body and make me a resurrected body that I can have with me into eternity. We spend a lot of money on our bodies here on earth. A lot of things that we like to do. But we need to spend money and time on the soul and on the spirit. If you look at the outline now, God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit are one. But they also have the ability to operate as three entities. So let me try to have you understand who God is. God is one, but he has three parts. If I'm here today, you see my body. My soul is inside my body. My spirit is inside my body. It would be nice if I could have my body resting, my soul is out working, and my spirit goes to church. But I cannot divide myself up. I can only be in one place at one time. People that do astral projection, their souls actually can leave their bodies, and the soul can go and travel all over the earth. But when you do astral projection, the body is limp. And it is not doing anything. So we are limited. And astral projection is done by demonic powers. Now God has a capacity to divide himself up. We have God the Father in heaven. God the Son came down on earth. And the Holy Spirit communicated between the two of them. Let's turn to the Gospel of John, chapter 5. It's the Gospel of John, chapter 5. And we want to pick it up from verse number 17. But Jesus answered them, "My Father works hitherto, and I work." Therefore the Jews sought the more to kill him, because he not only had broken the Sabbath, but said also that God was his Father, making himself equal with God. Then answered Jesus and said to them, "Verily, verily, I say unto you, the Son can do nothing of himself. But what he sees the Father do, what things soever that he does, these also does the Son likewise. For the Father loves the Son, shows him all things that himself does. He will show him greater works than these, that you may marvel. For as the Father raised up the dead and quickened them, even so the Son quickens whom he will." Imagine this now. God the Father is in heaven. Part of him is on earth, Jesus the Son. Jesus sees what the Father does, and Jesus does what the Father does, through the power of the Holy Spirit. Can we understand this intellectually? No. Our brain, physical brain, cannot do it. Our soul brain cannot do it. We just got to accept the fact this is the way it is and realize this is how God is. In John 14, verse number 6, we read the following. John 14 and verse number 6. Jesus said to him, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man comes unto the Father but by me. If you had known me, you should have known my Father also. And from henceforth you know him and have seen him. Philip said to the Lord, show us the Father, and it will suffice us. Jesus said unto him, have I been so long time with you, and yet you have not known me, Philip? He that has seen me has seen the Father. And how do you say then, show us the Father? Believe you not that I am in the Father in me? The words that I speak unto you, I speak that of myself. But the Father that dwells in me, he does the works. Believe me that I'm in the Father, and the Father in me, or else believe me for the very work's sake. So if you want to find out how does the Father think, read in the New Testament what Jesus said, what Jesus did, and the emotions that Jesus had. And now you have seen the Father. In Ephesians chapter 4, verse number 30, that's Ephesians chapter 4 and verse number 30, we read the following. And grieve not the Holy Spirit of God, whereby you are sealed unto the day of redemption. And grieve not the Holy Spirit of God, whereby you are sealed unto the day of redemption. God can be grieved. Now, when people grieve us, what happened to us? We get angry. We get upset. We simply don't like it. We get offended, right? We get offended. Now, if you walk into a restaurant and you sit down there and you might not particularly like the waitress or the waiter, and you know this by experience, if you shoot your mouth off and say, hey, stupid, why don't you send somebody else to serve me? I don't like your face. You know what's going to happen? You ain't eating in that restaurant. You're being escorted out. You're being told, you know, go some other place. So you know that if you want to eat at that restaurant, you shut your mouth, you put a smile on your face, and, you know, you're polite, and you get your food. Now, when it comes to God, we treat him like dirt. He has emotions. He has feelings. And we simply, you know, we don't have time for God. We don't read the Bible. We don't take time to pray. We start our morning off. And basically, you hear people say, oh, God! And you know when we say that? When we run into trouble. When we're doing fine, we don't pray. We say, okay, God, you do your thing. I'm doing my thing. You know, don't bug me right now. I'm having a good time. I'm riding my motorcycle. I'm out in my car. You know, I'm out in the range here. You know, I'm out swimming. You know, God, don't bug me right now. I don't want to be spiritual. I want to be fleshly. And God says, is that right? So we need to learn do not offend God. Turn to Exodus chapter 20. That's Exodus, the 20th chapter. Now, God has a lot of patience. He puts up with a lot of us. But you know, eventually, his patience will run out. There will come a time when God simply said, enough is enough. And we're going to have judgment. We don't think about it. And because God is long-suffering, we think, you know, he's just like Santa Claus, you know, he comes around again, you know, with more stuff, you know. And there comes a time, if you continue in your sins on a daily basis, a weekly basis, whatever you do, and then you repent and you go back and so on, let me tell you this, there will be a cut off time. And when that time comes, it doesn't matter what you will say. That's the time when you can't repent anymore. You can, oh, God, Lord, no. Lord, I'm changing my mind now. God said, shut up. This is it. I'm removing you from the earth. I'm taking your soul and spirit right now out of your body. And you're going to go to the judgment seat of Christ. He's going to take you to the woodshed. And you might be screaming and hollering, but you're a loving God. You're going to be told, shut your mouth. And at that time, you're going to realize that you need to respect God. You just offended God. You will never hear Joel Osteen say this. It would hurt his offering plate immensely. But I don't care about the offering plates. I care about truth. In Exodus chapter 20, if you read this, God spake all these words, saying, I am the Lord your God, which have brought you out of the land of Egypt, out of the house of bondage. You shall have no other gods before me. You shall not make unto you any graven image, or any likeness of anything that is in heaven above, that is in the earth beneath, or that is in the water of the earth. You shall not bow down yourself to them, nor serve them. For I, the Lord your God, am a jealous God, visiting the iniquity of the fathers upon the children unto the third and fourth generation of them that hate me. God is jealous. That's part of his emotional makeup. I try to help people understand in the following way. If I have a man or if I got a woman in deliverance, and most people have been involved in adultery, fornication, and stuff like this, and I ask them this. Now, if there's a man, I say this. What would you say if your wife would tell you over dinner table, that my old boyfriend 25 years ago found me on Facebook and invited me out for dinner? And, you know, I just felt, oh, yes, that would be nice. Now, I'm not going to have any sex with him. I might give him a kiss. I might give him a hug. We might eat dinner together. So, beloved husband, do you mind if I go out tomorrow night with my old boyfriend? And I never had a man yet say, oh, that's all right. They always say, no way. I don't share my wife with anyone. I ask a woman, what would you say if your husband said, you know, I got a couple of girlfriends, you know, they happen to be in town, two of them. And for good old times, you know, we're going to go out, you know, and have a good night on town. And, you know, wife, would you say, oh, well, God bless your husband, go and do it? No, she said, he can't do that. I won't share him. all or nothing. Hey, God is a jealous God. You and I are jealous. We are jealous over our spouses. We are jealous over our children. We are jealous over our friends. Somebody insult your friend or do something, jealousy is going to come up. You're going to deal with the issue. Do you realize that we on a daily basis, we are committing spiritual adultery? We are out having a fling with demons. We do this with Satan, you know, and we think nothing of it. And then we come home, you know, go to church, we go to God, read the Bible and pray, you know. And God said, where have you been? Well, I went out and had a drink with the boys. Or, you know, I went to the whorehouse. Went to the gambling joint. And God said, you know, you committed spiritual adultery. Go ahead. We don't understand that. You do it long enough, and eventually God will have the hammer come down. Look at this now. Now, I don't want you to feel scared. We just got to learn what God says, how he is. Now, God says this. If you offend me and have other gods, I will not only punish you, but your children, your grandchildren, and your great-grandchildren. We got to accept. That's what God thinks. That's how he is. That's what he will do. Think about this. You wonder why your children went astray. Go back and look upon your dad. Go back and look upon your grandfather, grandmothers. What did they do in the past? Well, they went to witchcraft. They went to false religions. They went to a number of different things. They went to Freemasonry. And God simply said there would be a curse coming down. So what we need to do is to recognize, I need to find out what happened in the past. I need to break some curses. The good news is we can break the curses. But if we don't break the curses, it will affect us and the generations to come. Now we're going to turn to Joshua. And we're going to read from chapter 7. That's Joshua chapter 7. And I don't want you to think now he's going to try to build a guilt trip on me. I'm not trying to build a guilt trip. I'm simply trying to tell you this how God thinks. This is how he operates. And so learn to get along with him. Just like you get along with people every day. It's not done by a guilt trip. It's done because you know that if you're going to navigate, you cannot offend people. Joshua 7, verse 1. But the children of Israel committed trespass in the accursed thing, for Achan, the son of Carmi, the son of Zabdi, the son of Sirath, of the tribe of Judah, took of the accursed things, and the anger of the Lord was kindled against the children of Israel. One man sinned. God's anger was kindled. And it was kindled not only against Achan, but it was kindled against all the people of Israel. It was a collective thing. We are having abortions in this country. We've had them since 1973. And I believe right now it's about 60 million children have been killed so far since 1973. Collectively, We are being judged for that as a nation. It's costing us. Now, as individuals, we can ask God to break the curse. We can ask God, we try to roll it back. We want to pray this weekend for a Supreme Court judge that would begin to be part of it, rolling back abortion. But I want you to slow down right now. Slow down and think. When other people sin, it will affect all of us. How do we get out from under that? By talking to the Lord. And we simply say, God, as an American, I repent. Forgive us as a nation. And we can get out of under the collective judgment. But most of us never think about it. We never pray about it. How much did it cost the children of Israel? So we read here from verse, let me read a couple of verses. I didn't have them listed, so this is the bonus here. And Joshua sent men from Jericho to Ai, which is beside Bethlehem, on the east side of Bethel, and spake unto them, saying, go up and view the country. And the men went up and viewed Ai. And they returned to Joshua and said to him, let not all the people go up, but let about 2,000 or 3,000 men go up and smite Ai, and make not all the people to labor thither, for they are but a few. In other words, piece of cake. We don't need a whole lot of people. About 2,000 or 3,000 of us, we're going to take care of this city, and we will wipe them out. They are history. So they went up thither of the people, about 3,000 men. And they fled before the men of Ai. And the men of Ai smote of them about 36 men. For they chased them from before the gate, even at the Shebarim, and smote them in the going down. Wherefore the hearts of the people melted and became as water. 36 men died for the sin of Achan. Let's do some more thinking here now. During the Revolutionary War, we had people rise up and said, we want to get rid of the tyranny. Some people had to die for that. Most of the people that signed the Declaration of Independence never saw the nation come into being. They paid with their life for it. Look upon the Civil War. About 600,000 men, both sides, lost their lives in the Civil War. Never had a chance to live out their lives. Died on the battlefield. World War I, more Americans had to die. World War II, millions died. Loss of lives. Is that God's perfect will? No. But this is the consequences of sin. The Revolutionary War was caused by sin, by the British king and the rulers and the Americans that cooperated with these people. The Civil War was fought over finances, over control. You've heard it was over slavery. Slavery was not the issue. It was a financial war. Control. World War I was fought over colonies. England wanted the German colonies in Africa. And they took them. It cost the war. World War II was fought over nothing. The United States built up Germany. We built up the Soviet Union. And they were plunged into war. For what? Money. financial gain, power. But somebody had to die. Do you realize that on D-Day, when they invaded Normandy in June 1944, the commander, the General Eisenhower, knew this, that the first wave that would land on the beaches would not make it. 100% casualty. They all died. They calculated this. We send in the first wave. They will do some damage. We send in the second wave. We lose about 80% of them. They get a bit further up the beach. We put in a third wave, and they push a bit further up. And by the fifth and the sixth wave, we are off the beach. What about the guys that got sacrificed? They got sacrificed. They never lived their lives out. So I want you to understand that somebody has to pay for things when there is sin in a nation. Let's turn to Psalm right now. We're going to turn to Psalm 2. Second chapter. Why did the heathen rage and the people imagine a vain thing? The kings of the earth set themselves in a rooted council together against the Lord, against his anointed, saying, let us break their bands asunder and cast away their cords from us. He that sits in the heavens shall laugh. The Lord shall have them in derision. When God sees men mocking him, he's laughing. He laughs at them. Why? Because he feels they are stupid. It would be like you are standing at your home and there's a bunch of ants coming in. And they're saying, we are many, we're going to conquer this house. And you laugh at them. And you get a spray bottle and you go, psh, and they all die. He that sits in the heavens shall laugh. The Lord shall tell them in derision. Then shall he speak unto them in his wrath and vex them in his sore displeasure. Look at the emotions now. God said, now I am sore displeased, and I will speak to them in my wrath. We drop down here in verse number 10. Be wise now, therefore, O you kings. Be instructed, you judges of the earth. Serve the Lord with fear and rejoice with trembling. Fear here means respect. You have respect. Now, we do know this. There's been a lot of people killed by policemen. And, you know, policemen can be very trigger happy. If you're in a situation where you get stopped and there's a policeman standing outside, you know, he got a gun, you want to make sure that you don't make him think that you're going to shoot him, because he would try to shoot you first. So it's not that you fear him, but you respect his gun, because he has it over you. And this is what we need to do with God. We need to simply respect him. And just like you respect one another. I'm not going to offend you, God. I love you, God. I want to get along with you. Kiss the Son. I like that. Who's the Son? Jesus Christ. Lest he be angry, and you perish from the way when his wrath is kindled but a little. Blessed are all they that put a trust in him. This was written 1,000 years before Christ. And David knew about the Messiah. He knew about the Son of God. And he said, kiss the Son, lest he be angry. And we need to treat Jesus very nicely. Now we're going to turn to a book that very few people have seen. That's Zephaniah. And it is at the very end of the Old Testament. So we're going to find Zephaniah. And he is up here. There he is. So you know what Habakkuk is, you can find Zephaniah. If you never read Habakkuk, you can find Haggai. And you, right before that, or, then you got Zechariah. And then, of course, you got Malachi. Now, remember this. You're walking in heaven one day when you get to heaven. And here comes a guy up to you and say to him, hello, my name is Zephaniah. Really? Well, my name is John. Did you read my book? What book? Well, I had a book in the Bible. Really? That's heavy, man. I never saw that. Oh. So now you know Zephaniah is in the Bible. Okay, let's read from chapter 1, verses 14 and 15. The great day of the Lord is near. It is near and hasteth greatly. Even the voice of the dead Lord, the mighty man shall cry there bitterly. That the day is a day of wrath, a day of trouble and distress, a day of wasteness and desolation, a day of darkness and gloominess, a day of clouds and thick darkness. So here is Zephaniah prophesying. There will be a day of judgment that will come. If you turn to Zephaniah chapter 3, verse number 17, you will also find this out, that God wants to be happy. He wants to have a good time. The Lord your God in the midst of you is mighty. He will save. He will rejoice over you with joy. He will rest in his love. He will joy over you with singing. That's what God wants to do. He wants to be happy. He wants to sing. He wants to rejoice over you. I want to give you a picture now. You got a house. You're in the backyard. And you are barbecuing. And you're going to have a nice dinner. Have a few friends there. Suddenly you hear a big bang and commotion on the front of the house. And you run out. And you see this guy has run into and creamed your car. And just made a mess out of it. And he's standing there and saying, well, I'm sorry, man. I was too drunk. You shouldn't park your car there anyway, you know. I need a wide street. Now, you're not going to say, hey, man, I just got some stuff on the barbecue grill. Come on in and have a dinner with me. You're not going to treat him like that. He's going to eat nothing of your barbecue stuff. He's going to eat something else. And before the cops come, you want to make sure that the guy has learned a lesson. So you punch him a few things, you know, make some holes in him. Take a few teeth out. Make it easy for him, you know, to swallow stuff. Now, so remember this now. God wants us to have a good time with you. So let's not upset God. We are saved. We are on our way to heaven. But we don't want to mistreat the Lord. This is what I'm trying to get across. Then turn to Psalm 103. Psalms 103. Bless the Lord, O my soul, and all that within me. Bless his holy name. Bless the Lord, O my soul, and forget all his benefits. Who forgives all your iniquities, who heals all your diseases. who redeems your life from destruction and crowns you with loving kindness and tender mercies, who satisfy your mouth with good things, so that your youth is renewed like the eagles. The Lord executes righteousness and judgment for all that are oppressed. He has made known his ways unto Moses, his acts unto the children of Israel. The Lord is merciful and gracious, slow to anger and plenteous in mercy. Notice now, we like these verses. God is merciful. But if you also read this, he's slow to anger. He was not only a child, neither would he keep his anger forever. He's not dealt with us after our sin, nor reward according to our iniquities. For as the heaven is high above the earth, so great is his mercy over them that fear him. As far as the east is from the west, so far as he removed our transgressions from us. Like as the father pities children, so the Lord pities them that fear him. God will never change. Turn to Isaiah chapter 45, verse 21. Tell you and bring them near. Yea, let them take counsel together. Who has declared this from ancient time, who told it from the time, have not I the Lord? And there is no God else beside me. A just God and a Savior, there is none beside me. Look unto me and be you saved, O the ends of the earth, for I am God and there is none else. I swore by myself, the words have gone out of my mouth in righteousness, and shall return, that unto me every knee shall bow, every tongue shall swear. So God is telling Isaiah this. I am God. There is no one else above me, besides me. I am it. I never change. I always existed. I always will exist. And then we read in chapter 46, verses 9 and 10. Remember the former things of old, for I am God, and there is none else. I am God, and there is none like me. So we need to understand now that God will never change. Let's turn to Malachi now. It's easy to find because you know where Matthew is. Malachi is just before Matthew. Chapter 3, verse 6. For I am the Lord, I change not. Therefore, you sons of Jacob are not consumed. God said, I do not change. And then Hebrews 13:8. That's Hebrews chapter 13, verse number 8. Jesus Christ, the same yesterday and today and forever. I tried here today to paint the picture for you. If you want to find out what God does today, find out what he did yesterday. What he did yesterday, he will do today. He will do the same thing tomorrow. God does not change. You and I change. Our friendship depends upon how we treat one another. If I happen to offend you, you're going to flip me off and say, hey, I don't want to be your friend anymore. Our friendship is based upon performance. I perform well, and you like me. I rub you the wrong way, I don't perform well, I'm out of your playbook. So much for that. Think about this. How many friends do you have that go back 5 years, 10 years, 15 years, 20 years, 30 years. You know what? You don't have a lot of friends going back that long. You might have one or two that goes back. Maybe you have somebody that goes back for 30 years, if you're old enough. But most of your friends are contemporary friends. They haven't been around that long. And the reason is, you got offended, they got offended, and you lost your friendship. Same thing in the family. You got your in-laws, you got your outlaws, you got your siblings. Some of them you get along with, and some you don't get along with. You got offended, they got offended. Learning to know God. I realize that I'm not going to be able to finish this sermon today. But what we want to do now is, we're going to go a couple of verses here. So turn with me to Jeremiah chapter 1. And we pick it up in verse number 1. God said this, "If you will return, O Israel, says the Lord, return unto me, and if you'll put away your abomination out of my sight, then shall you not remove." God is saying this to Israel, to Judah. Return unto me. God is saying this to you and me today. Return. Most of you that are watching me today or later listening, you are walking with the Lord. Some of you are walking more or less with the Lord. But God is saying this, I want you to walk with me 100%. I don't want to share you. I don't want you to be out kissing the devil 5% and give me 95%. I want 100%. So he's simply saying there, I want you to come back to me. I cannot really blame a lot of people. Let me share this with you. There's a lot of heresy. There's a church here in California, located in Redding, California, and it's called Bethel. The pastor there is Bill Johnson. And, of course, it's a well-known church in charismatic circles and in some Pentecostal churches. And they have a huge impact. They have, matter of fact, he is building campuses in many different places. Now, Bill Johnson came up with this. And this is what happens when you go outside the Bible. They really have into charismatic demon possession, demon oppression. They battle the spirit, speaking in tongues, casting out demons. Heavy, heavy into the supernatural. And he decided this, that, you know, we can get more anointing if we go to the cemeteries. So he's simply been teaching people this, that if you have people in the past that have been anointed by God, they're dead, find their graves, go to the cemeteries, and then hug the stone or lay down on the slab and try to suck up the anointing. The Bible said we shall not contact the dead. These people that were God's people are not in the grave. They're in heaven. Their bodies in the grave. And God never said in the Bible that we ought to go to cemeteries and try to do some grave sucking in order to get more power. Well, you got people now that, you know, think, you know what, they have Bethel, you know, they have all this stuff up happening. You know, it must be God, you know, so they get into it. What happened? Idolatry. And so God simply says, you know, you are out committing spiritual adultery. How can God bless that? He can't. He has to judge that. Now, Bill Johnson is going to be judged very hard. Because he's teaching this. But the people that he's doing it to, they're going to be judged too. And then you have people in other areas go to healing rooms and all kind of places, and they want to get the anointing, but it's a wrong anointing. So God said in verse number 1, return unto me. Put away your abominations. You might say, well, I don't do grave sucking. Well, you do Christmas. You do Halloween. You do a lot of other things. You do Valentine. You do the Easter bunny, the Easter egg hunt, and all kind of stuff like this. So you're still into idolatry. And you say, well, that's not idolatry. Anything that is touching into the occult is idolatry. And then we read in verse number 2, and you shall swear. Let's not talk about cursing now. This is talking about giving a promise. And you shall swear the Lord lives in truth, in judgment, and in righteousness, and the nations shall bless themselves with him, and in him shall they glory. So God now simply says this, I want a commitment. I want a commitment from you in deliverances that we do here. People call us up, write us, and say we want to get rid of demons. You know, can you cast the demons out? Yes, we can. We have that authority. But before you do that, you've got to line up with the Word of God. And we spend 90% lining people up with the Word of God. And this is, well, you know, that's not that important. It is important. It is very important that you simply have, you shall swear the Lord lives in truth, in judgment, in righteousness, in nations who bless themselves with him, and in him shall they glory. You got to make a commitment. To those of you that are married, to those of you who have been married, to you that think about getting married in the future, there will come a time when you will meet your spouse. Actually, you might be dating your spouse. If you're not doing that, you might just get to know your spouse. And there comes a time when you make it, you got to make a commitment. When that man asks you, will you marry me? You cannot say, well, I don't know. I'm thinking about it, possible, you know. And we'll see how things are going down the road. You want a commitment. You want yes or no. And you want the same thing from your husband to be. When he says, you know, I want to marry you. He says, okay, are you going to commit yourself to me? Nah, I don't want to tie myself up, you know. I mean, I used to have a lot of girlfriends, you know, so, you know, I like you, but I'm not going to tie myself down. You ain't going to marry him. So remember this. God wants a commitment. The third thing, remove your sinful lifestyle. Verse number 3. For thus says the Lord to the men of Judah and Jerusalem, break up your fallow ground and sow not among thorns. God is saying this. I want you to give up your sinful lifestyle. And you say, well, you don't have a sinful lifestyle. There's a lot of things we do. A lot of Christians are watching television. I'm not talking about news programs. They're watching soap operas. They're watching sitcoms, some old kind of garbage they have on it. And you're watching people getting divorced, people getting killed, people committing fornication and so on. And you say, that's entertainment. You have a sinful lifestyle. We need to be set apart. What's the difference? And I really want to shake your head this morning. If you are going down the road and you see a man beating a woman and he's bleeding, you stop your car and you got a gun, you got a club, you got something. Will you stand there and say, wow, what a blow. Man, you just knocked her ear off. Oh, wow, the teeth are going now. Will you stand there and watch her being killed and enjoy that? Of course not. Yesterday, in a restaurant someplace in the United States, there was one of the waitresses, a woman. She had a concealed permit that she packed heat. It was a customer in a restaurant. And he didn't like the waitress that was serving him. So he gave her a bad time. He decided, that he was not done with her. So he walked behind the counter and he started to punch this waitress in the back. This other waitress pulled a gun and said, "You got a choice, boy. Get out or I'll plug you." Well, he went out because he got arrested. Now, God wants us to be clean. Change your lifestyle. Part number four. God's promise to Judah. If you repent genuine and you change your way of living, you will not be subject to my wrath. Let's read verse number four. Circumcise yourself to the Lord. That is to the heart. Take away the foreskins of your heart. You men of Judah, inhabitant of Jerusalem, lest my fury come forth like fire and burn that none can quench it, because of the evil of your doings. This is what I want you to take home with you today. Learn how God thinks. Number one, make a decision. If you're out a little bit of the tulip, return unto God. Make a commitment to God. Change your lifestyle. And then, if repentance is genuine, God will not remove your candlestick. He will not remove your anointing. I'm speaking to Christians now. So I want you to understand, if you really want God's anointing, line up with the Lord. Just like you learn to line up with people around you. I share with you some things here from God. You can go in and read the Bible. There's many more places. And know that God has emotions. And God simply says this to us. I am emotional. I want to be happy. I want to have joy. I want to bless you. But don't cross me. If you cross me, I have anger. I have wrath. So we need. It's simple. If you understand that, shouldn't we treat God better than we treat one another? Shouldn't we be more sensitive to God than we are to one another? I made a joke yesterday. It was a joke in the car. We picked up a person from out of state. And I said, here in California, you've got to have seat belts. So I said, I'm concerned that you have a seat belt. So the person said, you're concerned about my well-being? No, I'm concerned about I don't want to pay a fine. So, we want to be careful with God. God loves us. Jesus loves us. The Holy Spirit loves us. And they say this to us. Work with us. Do what we tell you to do because it's best for you. Don't offend us. Don't give the devil a chance to put a claim in on you and complaint. But come to us. So if you really want to have a good life on earth, and you want your life to end well, then stop, think, and ask yourself this. How have I been treating God? How do I want to treat Him now? Treat Him better than people. And watch the power of God come down. The anointing coming down upon you. And you will have power to pray for other people. Power to live. The choice is yours. If you watch me today and you say, well, I'm not saved, and I like what I heard and I want to get saved, you can get saved right now. All you have to do is to recognize that you're a sinner and say, God, I sin. I need to be saved. I need to be forgiven. I believe that Jesus is the Son of God. He died on the cross, rose on the third day, and through death and resurrection, I can be saved. Forgive me, Lord, and He will. Now, when we close here, Charles Torell will come to you on the screen. You will not see him, but you will hear him. He will read some scriptures to you. He will take you through the plan of salvation. He will pray a sinner's prayer with you to make sure that you are saved. Write us, call us, so we can rejoice with you, give you some material, and help you do growth. To those of you that are already saved and watching, why don't you do this today? Examine your life. Simply ask yourself this. I want to talk to God and say this prayer. God, is there any time in my life that I have offended you? The Holy Spirit will tell you. And then you have the chance to say, God, I am sorry. Forgive me. I really am sorry I offended you, God. Didn't mean to. And He will forgive you. And the relationship will be restored. And then, picture this, taking the hand of God the Father and saying, let's just walk together and help me to love you and help me to do your will. May God bless you as you make that decision today. Here's Brother Thomas.
Father God, thank you for this beautiful day here today. And we thank you for your many blessings. Thank you for the word that is leading us and guiding us, Lord. We thank you for so much, Lord. We want to always be thankful. This is a Thanksgiving that we can have here every day, Lord. And we thank you, Father, for the gospel to go forth in the country and around the world, that people will hear and be able to receive and to live out their lives as according to your word. We thank you for these things. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Hello there, friend. You might have some questions about Christianity. There are many so-called Christian churches out there. So what makes a person a Christian? How do you get right with God? And how do you know when you die that you'll go to heaven? How exactly does a person get to heaven? Does God have a standard? And if so, what is it? What I'm about to tell you will be the most important information you will ever hear on this earth. And your decision will determine how you spend eternity. As you continue listening, I will explain. The bad news is this. When we are born into this world, we are automatically born with sin. Now you might think of yourself as a good person. After all, you're nice to other people, you give money to charity, and you try to live a good life. However, everyone has sinned and fallen short of God's standard. So it doesn't matter how moral, religious, or philosophical you are. You've broken God's commandments, and that has separated you from God. The Bible says in Romans 3:23, "For all have sinned and come short of the glory of God." Now you might say, "Well, I'm a good person. Doesn't that count for something?" Okay, let's take a little test. I'm going to ask you three questions. 1. Have you ever told a lie? 2. Have you ever stolen anything? Even something insignificant like a paperclip at work? 3. Have you ever lusted after someone of the opposite sex? Okay, how did you do? Most likely you answered yes to all three questions, which means you just failed the test. You see, these three questions are but three of God's 10 commandments. Failing just one commandment disqualifies you from getting into heaven and has condemned you to hell. This is why the Bible says in Romans 6:23, "For the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord." You see, God knows that we are all guilty of breaking His commandments. That's why He said we've all sinned and fallen short of His standard. But you don't have to be depressed about this. I do have some good news to share with you. In Romans 5:7 through 8, it says, "For scarcely for a righteous man will one die, yet peradventure for a good man some would even dare to die. But God commends His love toward us in that, while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us." You see, God loves you so much that He gave His only begotten Son, Jesus Christ, to pay for the sin in your life. Jesus was more than just a good man. He was God becoming man and walking among us. That is why Jesus died on the cross. He took your place and paid for your sins with His shed blood so that you can have everlasting life. God loves you so much that He sent His own Son to pay a debt He did not owe, because you owe a debt you could not pay. Jesus bridged the gap created by sin between you and God. The Bible says in John 3:16, "For God so loved the world that He gave His only begotten Son, that whosoever believes in Him should not perish, but have everlasting life." You see, there are three places we can exist in this universe: earth, heaven, and hell. So when we die here on earth, we don't just cease to exist. We will step out of our physical bodies and go to one of two places, heaven or hell. God did not send His Son to condemn you, but that through Jesus you might be saved and have eternal life in heaven. God's free gift to you is eternal life through His Son, Jesus Christ. That is why Jesus said, "I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man comes to the Father but by me." You see, God offers His love to you through Jesus, even though you are a sinner. This unmerited grace is not something you can buy or earn, but a gift from God. As you're listening right now and realize you're a sinner, know that God loves you and wants to save you. All you need to do is repent of your sins and ask God to forgive you. The word repent means to change your direction. You've been running away from God. Now it's time to start running toward Him. The Bible says in Psalms 103:12, "As far as the east is from the west, so far has He removed our transgressions from us." That means if you call out to God and confess your sins, He will forgive you. What Jesus has done in the past for others, He will do for you. If you call out to Him, He will answer you. He won't look down upon you because of your past, and there isn't a sin so great that it can't be forgiven. All He wants for you is to come to Him. He will help anybody who calls out to Him. If you have sin in your life, God still loves you. If you ask God to save you, He will do so. It is important to remember that talking to God can be done anywhere and anytime. You don't have to be in church to talk to God. He will meet you wherever you are. As you're listening to me right now, if you feel a conviction of sin in your life, that is God's Holy Spirit moving upon you. Friend, you need to repent of your sins right now and call out to Jesus. You might not get another chance. The Bible says today is the day of salvation. Friend, you need to make a decision today, one that will affect you for eternity. You have a choice. The road to hell is paved with good intentions, so act today. I would like to lead you in a prayer right now where you can ask Jesus Christ to come into your life and be your personal Lord and Savior. Now you might ask, what you just said, exactly what does that mean? Well, if you want to start anew and have your sins forgiven, Jesus is the way. There is no other way to God than through Jesus. I'm not talking about being religious. I'm talking about having a personal relationship with the God of creation who loves you so much and is just waiting for you to reach out to Him. That is what I mean by asking Jesus to come into your life and save you. Won't you pray with me right now? God, I confess that I am a sinner and that I need to be saved from my sins. Jesus, I ask that you would forgive me of my sins. I turn from them now and I put my faith in you. Come into my life and be my Lord and Savior. I believe that you paid for my sins on the cross through your shed blood, and that you died for me and rose from the grave. Save me, Jesus. I know I can't save myself. Thank you for saving me and giving me eternal life and a place in heaven with you. Help me to be obedient and to walk with you. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. If you just prayed with me and asked Jesus to save you, you are now a Christian. You have become born again and are a new creation in God's eyes. The Bible says in Romans 10:13, "For whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved." You see, you're not saved because you might feel saved, but because you have called upon God and He has saved you. Now, as a way to grow closer to Him, the Bible tells you to follow up on your commitment. Spend time with God each day. It doesn't have to be a long period of time. Just develop a daily habit of talking with Him and reading the Bible. Ask God to increase your faith and understanding of the Bible. Also, find a local church where you can worship God and seek fellowship with other Christians to answer your questions and support you. Be sure they use a King James Bible if you live in an English-speaking country, and that the pastor teaches out of the Bible. Plus, don't forget to share your new faith in Jesus with somebody else. After all, if I didn't make this recording to share with you, how would you have heard the good news? Finally, please contact us and tell us about your decision. We will send you some written material that will help you in your new walk with Jesus. This is Charles Torell with European American Evangelistic Crusades. May you grow in grace and in the knowledge of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. To Him be glory both now and forever.
You've been listening to the weekly webcast of Pastor John S. Torell. This message was the ninth part in the series, The Prophet Jeremiah, and was entitled Emotions and Choices. God never changes. That can be difficult for mankind to understand since we are ruled by our emotions, and they often betray us. However, just like us, God has emotions, but they do not rule Him. We all react to the environment around us, and our responses vary from muted to violent eruptions. But even when the response is outwardly muted, that does not mean that everything is calm inside. The trend is to control your emotions and make sure that you do not antagonize other people. We don't do this because we like them, but because our behavior can affect us in a positive or negative manner. When it comes to God, there is often no consideration that we might be grieving the Lord or what He wants from us. God can be jealous and angry, but it is always directed at those who rebel. The Lord is merciful and wants to be joyful. The book of Jeremiah is a rich source for how God thinks and what He desires of us. He wanted a commitment from the people of Judah, for them to repent and remove the sinful lifestyle. But that was not to be the case. They just wanted God's blessing, but they had no desire to please Him. This message is available on CD and DVD. When ordering, ask for sermon number 1659. There are several ways to contact our ministry. You can visit our website at eaec.org. There you can read insightful articles, watch or listen to a sermon broadcast, and explore the online store. The web address once again is eaec.org. If you prefer to write, address your envelope to European American Evangelistic Crusades, Post Office Box 166, Sheridan, California, 95681. That's Post Office Box 166, Sheridan, California, 95681. If you prefer to call us, the number is 916-944-3724. That's 916-944-3724. Resurrection Life of Jesus Church is sponsored by European American Evangelistic Crusades, and this has been a production of EAEC. Thanks for joining us today, and until next time, may God richly bless you as you read your Bible and walk with Him.